So I'm going to talk about monetary policy. It's a subject I've loved for many years, actually, since I was an undergraduate in college. I got interested in it. I'm still plugging away, trying to make some sense of this difficult subject. And I want to talk a little bit about what works and what doesn't. That's the title. And so I'm going to lead into that. It's a big subject, monetary policy, for just an hour, 15 minutes or so. But I'm going to try to cover some theory, some history, and some current events as much as I can. In a way, monetary policy is a good first lecture, first discussion, because it involves supply and demand, it involves public policy. It's a very political subject, and it's global. It's all over the world. In fact, we can think about, we really have a global monetary system. So it has all the things that are so important for us in this summer boot camp. So I have some slides, hope you can see them okay. First thing I want to start with, what the hell is money? Good place to start, of course, on a lecture in monetary economics. So for economists, money has a very specific definition. It's the part of your wealth that you can use to make transactions, part of your wealth, part of what you own to make transactions. And that's not everyday usage, of course. A lot of people use the word money like this, hey, she makes a lot of money. That's not the way that economists think of money. Money is the amount that you have in your wallet or your purse or your bank that you can use for transaction purposes. This is a famous piece of money that was used on an island in the South Pacific. It's called the Yap Island and the Yap money. And there I am on vacation. I'm not guaranteeing it was the same place I had the vacation, but I had a vacation Hawaiian shirt on, and that's a piece of money. And so people in this island used this gigantic stone for money, and it was a pretty good store of wealth. It didn't really matter if you had it in your backyard or underwater, a little bit that, but it's a famous story. It's written about all the things that could be money, and one is this thing called Yap money. But economists like to think of money in a more definitional sense. So let's just get rid of that. So first, just maybe a little question. Which of the following would be money based on what I've already said? Well, not a credit card. A credit card, just a piece in your wallet or your body. iPhone, well, you can kind of use it to make payments, but it's not part of your wealth that's used for transactions. Check in your checkbook, well, just a piece of paper. It's not really money. It's not money. 500 euro currency note, yes, of course. That's money. It can be used for transaction purposes. And a diamond ring, well, might accept that for payment, but rarely to use diamond rings for transaction purposes. So the answer here is D. So that means you want to think a little bit about why money is hard to measure in practice, especially in this modern world that we have at this point. And you can make payments through iPhones, but if you don't have some payment that's being used to make it, it's not money. But it makes it hard to measure, and you're going to see why that makes monetary policy hard. It's hard to measure money. It's hard to find just the things, the part of your wealth is just used for transactions. And you can become more efficient in using whatever you have through these modern technologies such as iPhones. You like to think about money being used in different ways in different countries. That makes it even harder. Some countries' currency is used all over the place. Some countries it's not used very much. Japan currency is still used quite a bit. This is a picture of Iraq. At one time in my life, I was responsible for setting up a central bank in Iraq. And to get it started, we had to get some currency into the country. We knew they used just currency, so we found a lot of currency that was frozen from Saddam Hussein's account. So we shipped it over there to be used. This guy in the blue shirts, David Numme, he worked for me at the Treasury at the time. The box is full of money. So they use money for transaction purposes. They didn't use bank accounts very much. They still don't use it very much. So it's a different concept of money that's being used. But nonetheless, it's a picture of them counting, our US military counting the money and David delivering the money to the central bank people in Iraq. Okay, so what do we think about a very important concept of economics is the three functions of money. And one of my favorite textbooks on economics is written by Richard Scarry. You might know that. So I have some examples. Medium of exchange. So this is Farmer Alfalfa selling some of his produce to Grocer Cat. in exchange for money. So it's a medium of exchange. This is Farmer Alfalfa buying a toy and some earrings for his family, using money for the to pay for this to the, I think it's blacksmith Fox. So that's a medium of exchange, important things. Also a store of value. So Farmer Alfalfa takes what he didn't buy, he puts it in the bank. So that money has to be a store of value. So it can change its value very rapidly. That's one of the problems that we're having with Bitcoin. Change its values a lot. And also as a unit account. So these three things are important. Now I give an example of a unit of account from a US dollar, which is pretty steady, pretty stable, doesn't change its value quite a bit. But next to that, I have a picture of a Zimbabwe note, which I have to prove exists. So no self-respecting economist walks around without a $100 trillion note from Zimbabwe. So that's Zimbabwe dollars, of course, but they had a terrible inflation, and so it wasn't a very good unit of account. So they started using dollars as a unit of account. All that meant is when you sold a house or a car, you quoted in dollars, even though the payment might have been made in Zimbabwe dollars. Okay, so that's the unit of account. So you want to have all three things of these things, and if you don't have these things, it's not very useful for money. Okay, so there's just the basics. Probably one of the most important principles of monetary economics, which we forget a lot, is the idea that inflation comes from printing too much money. It's a very common idea, in fact, that central banks have to worry about that. We have very high inflation, obviously, in Zimbabwe a few years ago. We have high inflation in Turkey right now. Venezuela, of course, is a disaster case. Argentina. These are actually, if you look at what's underlying these terrible inflation performances, these extremes, it's printing too much money. So a higher rate of money growth ultimately causes higher inflation. Other things equal. Now, one way to remember this and the way economists use this simple principle is through a famous formula that Milton Friedman, our former colleague here, would use all the time. So this is an equation. It's called the quantity equation of money. It's famous. Milton Friedman wrote much about this concept. He wrote a book at the bottom of the slides called Money Mischief. He argued that the quantity equation plays the same foundation stone role in monetary theory that Einstein's E equals MC squared does in physics. So that's a pretty powerful analogy, maybe a little bit of extreme for the purposes of selling his book, but whatever. So the quantity equation is up at the top. It is an equation, it's equal sign. M is money, V is velocity. It's how many times money turns over during a year or a month or whatever. P is the average price of goods and services in the economy, sometimes called the price level, just average all the prices that you're buying or selling with. And Y is real GDP. It's the total amount of production of goods and services in a country, in this case the US, in a particular period of time. So this holds as an identity because you can define velocity as the ratio of PY over M. Nonetheless, it's a very useful concept if you think of velocity as being relatively stable. Now this quantity equation, MV equals PY, by the way, this little license plate over in the corner was Milton Friedman's license plate. Pretty impressive. I have my own version. He gave me a copy of my prized possessions, his California license plate, MV equals PY. But you can use this. Hope that helps you remember it. I forgot to bring the license plate today, sorry. But I hope this helps you remember it. When economists use the quantity equation, they usually use it in growth rate form. And as of course, the growth rate of a product is the sum of the growth rates of each term in the product. So the growth rate of M times V is the sum of the growth rate of M plus the growth rate of V. And so that's what that says. So money growth, the percentage change in M, plus velocity growth, the percentage change in velocity, equals inflation, which is the percentage change in the price level from year to year. Remember, inflation is the percentage by which prices increase in a particular period of time. And real GDP growth, of course, is the percentage change in Y over time. So that means we have this example. So if money growth is 4% and velocity growth is 0.5% per year, if the inflation rate is 2%, then real GDP growth would be 2.5%. So that's hold. So then it becomes useful if you can then take this equation and say, well, what if the central bank increases money growth? What's going to happen? And so if you say, well, let's say velocity is pretty steady. Let's assume that real GDP is kind of growing as a normal rate over time. Then the big thing which will change is P. So you change M, V is constant, Y is constant, P is going to change. And so in growth rate terms, if you increase the growth rate of M from 4 to 8, that's doubling in a 4% increase. That's going to increase inflation from 2 to 6%. So that's the idea. That's how Milton Friedman used it. That's how monetary economists for many years have used this idea. Very simple. Of course, is underlined is the steadiness of V, and V is not very steady, as we'll see in a few minutes. And so that's led to a lot of debates about how monetary policy actually works. And I want to go through those a little bit in this discussion. Okay. So it's hard to make the quantity equation work. In certain cases it does. I guarantee you Zimbabwe, it worked just fine. Money growth was increasing a lot as they tried to finance spending. And I'll show you in a minute, we had a very high inflation rate in the 1970s in the US, sometimes called the great inflation. It worked very well then. But it's less reliable in the short run. And you could say the short run is when inflation is kind of low or when you're looking at just a year or two. It's not really as useful as it would be in the long run. Give some examples of that. And then, of course, other things change. Velocity changes. Maybe technology, the use of iPhones to make payment is going to make a certain amount of money more efficient, so velocity will change. And, of course, there's the impact on real GDP. If the Fed increases money growth right away, then the economy will probably boom for a while and inflation comes later. So this makes monetary policy a very difficult political issue. In the US and other countries. And I want to give some examples of that history a little bit. It's very important, actually, for studying history. Now, because money and monetary policy is so important, most countries have appointed a particular agency of government to do this. They don't always work very well. That's part of what I'm talking about, what works and what doesn't. But countries have established central banks. The central bank are central bank in the US is the Fed. It's given responsibility by the Congress according to the Constitution. Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution reads, Congress has the power to coin money, regulate the value thereof, and so the Fed is really responsibility of the Congress. The Fed has a particular structure. It's been in existence since the Fed was founded over 100 years ago. It has a board of governors. There's seven. There's actually only three on the board right now. It's pretty amazing. You have a chair, Jay Powell, and you have two members. Only two have been appointed by Trump, and there's three in the wings. So it's only three of the seven are there. You've got not only appointed by the president, but confirmed by the Congress. And then you have a bunch of other people who are the presidents of the local San Francisco, New York, Atlanta banks. And there's 12 of them, and together they make up something called FOMC, Federal Open Market Committee, a group which has the responsibility of setting monetary policy. They had the responsibility to increase money growth and decrease money growth under Burns and Volcker, and they have the responsibility today. Of course, there are other central banks around the world. I'll come back to that before I'm done. So this is a picture of some of the central bank governors. Up on the upper right is Jay Powell, the head of the Federal Reserve. Well, under him is Yi Gang, is the new chairman, new governor of the People's Bank of China. You have Elvira Nabiullina for Russia. You have, of course, the president of the European Central Bank, Mario Draghi, and Bank of England, Bank of Japan. So this is a big deal. This is global. And each of these countries have different senses of how monetary policy should work. But there's a convergence of it. I'm going to come back to that idea before I'm finished here. This is just a little anecdote. Sometimes central banks are created. This one was created in Iraq after Saddam Hussein fell. And so the new governor is on the left. He's the guy with no hair, Saddam Shabibi. And I'm on the right telling him what to do. So somebody actually asked me what to do about the money supply in Iraq. Actually did quite well in the money supply, on the economic side. It's not so good on a lot of other things, of course, but the monetary side was fortunately pretty good.